The NBA, city officials, and the Maloofs all reach a tentative deal to keep the Kings in Sacramento. What city council members are saying tonight about the next step.
Several inches of snow has fallen in the Sierra, and more is on its way. Coming up, how one business is getting a boost because of it.
You see the snow there? There it is on Doppler. But out there in the Pacific, there is a winter storm heading our way. I'll show you the impact on that in just a couple of minutes.
I'm Galston Dark.
And I'm Kelly McMullen. Those stories plus two officers hurt during a clash near the state capitol today.
KCRA 3 News begins now.
The Kings are one step closer to a new arena and staying in Sacramento after the NBA and the mayor, Kevin Johnson, announced a tentative deal to keep the team in the capital of California for the long haul.
And I really just want to jump up and down because I'm really excited. So I'm trying to be a mayor right now, if you don't mind.
The Kings Arena deal has our full focus tonight.
KCRA3's David Bienick is live for us at City Hall tonight, where council members will still have to vote on this plan. But first, we're going to go live to Power Balance Pavilion and Walt Gray with a closer look at the developments in Orlando today. Walt?
Galston, there's much joy out here tonight. Not only will the Kings remain in Sacramento, but it appears they're going to be playing soon in the league's newest arena. It seemed for years that this deal would never get done, but tonight looks pretty good.
Very excited. It's a new day for Sacramento.
After 3 days of bleary-eyed talks with the NBA and the Maloofs in Orlando, Mayor Kevin Johnson could barely contain himself. A tentative deal has been reached to find a way to pay for a $406 million arena.
Our family is just so excited that we have a framework for a deal, and that we've always said we wanted to stay in Sacramento, and now here's our opportunity.
I cannot thank the Maloof family enough. I cannot thank the commissioner and the NBA for the role that they've played. And I really just want to jump up and down because I'm really excited, so I'm trying to be a mayor right now.
It's been a long time, 13 years, as you know. Give me a minute.
These are tears of joy, though, Kevin.
Yeah.
You want me to say something?
Tears of joy.
The proposed home for the Kings will be ready for the 2015 season and serve as a catalyst for downtown redevelopment.
There have been some who suggested it was a fool's errand, but I don't think any of us felt the least bit foolish. We think this was a worthy cause, a worthy goal, and if you bang your head against the wall enough, you get good results.
The commissioner is quite the wordsmith. Kings host Utah tomorrow night here. They're 6.5 games out of the last playoff spot in the West. Now that the arena is shaping up, it's time for the Kings on the court to follow suit. This by no means is a done deal, this new arena. Following that end of the story and the city council vote to come, my colleague David Bienick at City Hall.
Yeah, good evening, Walt. We've spoken so far with five of the nine council members here in Sacramento. All said they still have some questions about this tentative deal that's been worked out. Among those questions, how will the city fill an estimated $9 million hole in its annual budget to be created if the city leases its parking spaces to a private company? Also, exactly how long would that parking deal last? 30 years, 40 years, 50 years? And what does the city plan? When does the city plan to sell off its land near the current arena site? Right away to raise instant cash for the arena project, or in a few years from now when the property values are expected to rise?
What's your sense of the likelihood that this will pass when it comes before City Council next week?
Well, if it includes all the things that we've laid out over the past few weeks, which it sounds like it does, then I think we have a really good shot. Can't wait to see the details.
I'm going to want to look at the details, make sure it's pretty close to what we set out to do. But from what I hear, it is. So I'm trying to not to get too excited till I hear more of the details.
You know, I just want to make sure that all the things that we've been saying that we're, looking at from our perspective, the general fund's in good shape, you know, it's protected, and, it's a fair deal going forward for everyone.
Council members expect to get a briefing here at City Hall tomorrow. Now, in addition to those three council members we heard from just there, we also spoke with Council Member Jay Chenier and Council Member Daryl Fong. They say they, too, have some questions. And Council Member Daryl Fong said he's still concerned about the timeline on this, having to vote on this in just a week and a day from now. He said he compared it to trying to take a test in school without doing the homework.
Live at Sacramento City Hall, David Bina, KCRA 3 reports.
It'll be interesting to see what happens in the next few days. Thanks, David. Well, for complete coverage of the Kings Arena deal, anytime you want it, just go to KCRA.com, and that's where you will find the very latest news on the efforts to keep the Kings in Sacramento.
To KCRA 3, weather now, and snow is falling in the Sierra. Take a look at this. It's causing quite the traffic mess there on Interstate 80. I-80 and Truckee looked more like a parking lot earlier this afternoon. Chains, by the way, are required in both directions.
And we have this shot now at Highway 50 at Myers. Snow falling there this afternoon, but the roads stayed fairly clear. Chain controls are in effect from Twin Bridges out to Myers.
And check out Highway 50 at Ski Run. The camera there was iced over earlier, but it looks like it may have warmed up a little bit, and traffic seems to be moving along just fine. We have live team coverage tonight. KCRA 3's Janet O is live in Nyack in Placer County. But first, let's start with Chief Meteorologist Mark Finan.
It's been a really interesting day. Well, many people in the valley saw just nothing but sunshine and a few clouds. You just saw it has been a snowy day in the Sierra. Let me give you a closer look. This is where we're seeing the snow right now, basically above about 4,000 feet in this time lapse over the last hour. You can see that it's somewhat decreasing. It's coming up from the south, and you can see now south of Highway 50, it really is beginning to wane a little bit. I mean, I do expect we'll continue to see that pattern as we go through the next few hours. So this area of snow will be decreasing. But I did get a call from one of our weather watchers over by Carnelian Bay, and he said he'd had a foot of snow so far today. You can see now on Interstate 80 up over Donner Summit, there's still some snow, but coming down the hill, it becomes a bit more hit and miss. And I think the pictures from Interstate 80 have also borne that out. Let's go to KCRE3's Janet O. She joins us live from Nyack. And Janet, an hour ago was snowing pretty good, but now it looks as though it's just kind of down to some flurries.
Yeah, a few flurries here and there, but it wasn't coming down as hard as it was an hour ago when we last spoke to you. Now, you can see all the snow that has already come down here in Nyack where we are, and drivers we spoke to say they were caught off guard as they had to wait to put snow chains on. Meantime, all this snow means good business for snow chain installers. Driving along Interstate 80 in Placer County, drivers were greeted with this familiar sign, snow chains required. But unfortunately for Sierra Chain Service, it's been an unusually dry winter and very slow for business until now.
Oh, we're loving it. You know what? We need snow. People don't realize how important this is to our economy up here in the Sierras.
Caltrans had plows out working around the clock to clear up the slushy mess. It wasn't too bad, crews say, an easy cleanup job. Still, one that led to many spinouts and minor accidents, especially near the Donner Lake interchange where traffic came to a halt for nearly an hour. Chris Rogers had to keep his patience for the long drive back home from Reno.
Definitely not anticipating it.
How do you feel about being stuck in traffic trying to get home?
It's frustrating.
Tow trucks were also on standby throughout the day. They say speed is a likely cause for most of the problems.
And they're going a little bit too fast, and they slide, get out of control, hit their brakes, slide off the side of the road, you know, go off the embankment a little bit.
Caltrans says it hasn't seen this much snow in a day this winter, and more is in the forecast for Wednesday. It's what snow chain installers call a typical Sierra winter.
So we're just glad we can get anything we can get at this point.
Now, snow chains are required right now on the westbound side from Boca to Kingsville, and on the eastbound side from Kingsville to Boca. Caltrans says that traffic is clear right now, but it is expecting it to be busy for the next 3 days. Gulston and Kelly, back to you.
Janet, thanks very much.
Well, while the Sierra gets some real winter weather today, take a look at what it was like in Sacramento and the surrounding area. The sun shining on the bike path at Discovery Park this afternoon. Nice conditions to get out and take a walk with the dog, or maybe even a little jog.
What a difference between that and where Janet is. Well, not just Northern California seeing some snow today. Take a look at the Cajon Pass area and the San Bernardino Mountains. Elsewhere on I-5, the freeway is back open over the Grapevine. It was closed for hours today because of snow.
And remember, you can stay up to date on the weather 24/7 when you click to KCRA.com. Just go to Weather for interactive radar, the 7-day forecast, information about chain controls, and a link to our KCRA3 SkyCam network. It's all waiting for you there. Meanwhile, a melee at the state capitol today as separate protest groups clashed with each other and police. At least two officers were injured when members of the Occupy Oakland movement faced off with a pro-white group.
The action was caught on camera by a KCRA3 insider who shared his video with us. Take a look. Now, this was the start of the afternoon clashes right near 10th and K Streets. You can hear officers on horses ordering people to get out of the way. A little later, an officer there got off his horse, chases this guy down in the street. He jumps on him, takes him to the ground. As you can see here, more officers come in to help. Officers also detained a second man in the area.
KCRA3's Danielle Lee joins us live right now from downtown with more on what led up to the confrontations earlier today. Danielle.
Golston, I want to set the scene here for you. Police say that a pro-white group was protesting at the Capitol. Meanwhile, another group who has identified themselves as Occupy protesters say they were counter-protesting on the sidewalk. Now, police say that they were trying to keep the two groups separate for several hours when both groups converged on this intersection at 10th and L right around 3 p.m. Police say that is when things got violent, forcing them to shut down 10th Street here until just about 20 minutes ago.
Somebody behind me threw a bottle, and then it was just like, run, run, and we were running down the sidewalk.
This Occupy Sacramento protester is describing the beginning of an altercation between two opposing groups of protesters that ended with dozens of officers in riot gear blocking off several downtown streets.
It was the most violence I've ever experienced firsthand in my life.
At least two officers trying to separate the protesters were hurt, and officers say the Occupy protesters turned on them, throwing bottles and paint.
In your opinion, though, under any circumstances, is it appropriate to throw paint or assault a police officer?
I'm not going to answer that.
I think it was out of line, but when you're dealing with hatred, people sometimes respond with hatred.
Officers say they arrested four people for the violence. Officers say the violence was initiated by the Occupy protesters. Those protesters admit they came to the Capitol without permits to counter-protest against another lawful protest by a group known as the South Africa Project. Many are calling them white supremacists, and police say they had to escort the group out of the downtown area to safety.
And we felt that we just don't want them in our cities.
I was only able to spot two members of that South Africa group as they were rushing out of here. I did try to talk to them to get their reaction to these events, and there was nothing that they wanted to say. We are also following the condition of those two officers who were injured. We haven't been able to get an update, but I will let you know as soon as we find that out when the KCRA3 night team reports at 10 and 11. Reporting live in Sacramento, Danielle Lee, KCRA3 night team.
Danielle, thanks. Looking ahead at this time tomorrow night, the Stockton City Council will decide whether to enter into a mediation process in hopes of saving the city from bankruptcy. The process to restructure their finances could last anywhere from 60 to 90 days. If, in the end, city leaders decide to file bankruptcy, Stockton would be the largest U.S. city to file for Chapter 9 protection. City Manager Bob Dice says the city is on the hook for $450 million in employee benefits it can't pay for. City Council members say they would not comment until tomorrow night's meeting.
Well, a Southern California state senator recovering after a double lung transplant tonight. That story's still ahead.
Also, the search for murder victims of these so-called speed freak killers taking another twist as bounty hunter Leonard Padilla gets another letter from death row inmate Wesley Shermantine, what the serial killer is telling him tonight.
And preparing high schoolers for jobs in a new economy, the local program getting teens ready.
KCRA 3 News continues.
The San Joaquin County Sheriff's Department says investigators are doing everything they can to find the human remains believed to belong to victims of Wes Shermantine and Lauren Herzog. But as KCRA 3's Melinda Meza reports tonight, there is increasing pressure to bring in the FBI.
It's quiet today in Linden. No excavating, no digging in wells looking for more murder victims. But family members of these victims are asking why.
This is reopening some very, very painful memories for many, many families who have loved ones that went missing. And so to prolong it only tortures them more.
Assemblymember Kathleen Galjani has been in contact with many of the victims' families and her own family, who believes they have a loved one missing.
The San Joaquin County Sheriff's Department is in charge of this murder investigation, but many people are hoping the FBI will get involved. Assemblywoman Kathleen Galjani drafted this letter with a personal appeal to the FBI, asking them to bring in their resources so family members could find the answers they're looking for.
Like the family members of 16-year-old Joan Hobson. From death row, Shermantine sent yet another letter to Sacramento bounty hunter Leonard Padilla today. Shermantine writes, "I want to know the results of the DNA test and if they found Joan Hobson. Then we'll go from there."
Joanna Hobson's mom, Shelley. I mean, she's been looking for her daughter now for all these years.
Joan's mother has also received letters from Sherman Tunnel. And although she does not want to talk on camera, she hopes more equipment from the FBI and more searching will take place. In Linden, Melinda Meza, KCRA 3 reports.
And Melinda says the San Joaquin County Sheriff has confirmed that he has met with the FBI, the Department of Justice, and the DA to discuss how to best proceed with future searches.
Well, a new report out by the Legislative Analyst's Office says California's tax revenues will fall $6.5 billion short of what Governor Jerry Brown had predicted. If that happens, it could cause the state's current $9.2 billion deficit to rise. However, the LAO recommends that lawmakers wait until more information becomes available, and that will happen at the end of April.
We're not going to jump to any conclusions. We're concerned. But until we see those April tax receipts, we won't know where we stand in terms of deficit.
Meantime, the LAO did find that California can expect to get a boost from Facebook's initial public offering. The report says that it could increase state revenue by $500 million during the current fiscal year.
A state senator recovering tonight from a successful double lung transplant. Sharon Runner expected to be released from the UCLA Medical Center in about 2 to 3 weeks. The senator has what's called limited scleroderma, or crest syndrome, I should say. It's an autoimmune condition that attacks the body's connective tissue. Senator Runner's districts include parts of Kern, Los Angeles, San Bernardino, and Ventura counties. A new $3.2 million program will help prepare California's high school students for jobs in clean energy and renewable energy. Senate Pro Tem President Daryl Steinberg and the California Energy Commission spoke about the importance of California partnership academies like this at Laguna Creek High School in Elk Grove. Students in the Green Academy study the technology of renewable energy through these kind of hands-on project-based projects.
We can't just teach courses in the same old way and expect that young people are going to, one, remain interested, and two, gain the education and the skills necessary to be able to succeed in the workforce.
Legislation by Steinberg approved last year called for creating and investing in clean energy and technology academies. They'll receive funding in installments as they first launch their new programs, then demonstrate success. There are 21 funded green academies.
All right, KCRA 3 weather for you today, and some snow falling in Cedar Ridge in Nevada County this afternoon. You can see it coming down fairly fast there. That means it's wet and slushy there, but of course, in the higher elevations, snow sticking. Of course, the businesses up there happy about that.
Absolutely, and we kind of noticed the real difference, Mark, between the valley and in the Sierra today.
Absolutely, and Cedar Ridge, one of those spots, well, you saw some snow showers there. Cedar Ridge, one of those spots that might end up with accumulating snow later on this week. Right now, it's clear and cool in the valley. We have 53 degrees, a little breeze out of the west at 5. It's also mainly clear in Stockton, where we also have a pretty cool evening, 53 degrees. It's going to be a pretty chilly night tonight. In Modesto, we have clear skies already down to 51. We'll be in the 30s early tomorrow morning. In Fairfield, we're mainly clear, a few clouds here and there, and 50 degrees with a breeze out of the west at 12. And at Tahoe, it's still snowing. There's the parking lot from our Lake Tahoe Sky Cam, and you can still see the flakes falling here. You see this van down here just covered in snow. It's 26 degrees with a little breeze out of the north at 5 miles an hour. Just a great shot from our Lake Tahoe Sky Cam. Let me show you that snow on Triple Doppler. There it is, covering Lake Tahoe. But this area is really decreasing, and I think that'll continue through the night tonight. And so if you're looking to drive into the Sierra, I think tomorrow morning might be a good time to do that, because this weather system will be on the way out, and then it'll be awaiting the next one heading our way tomorrow night and into the day on Wednesday. This next storm is going to have a pretty big impact on the Sierra. Let me show you that. Let me show you what we're expecting. The elevations above about 5,000 feet, this is Interstate 80, will end up with about 3 feet of snow, maybe even more right up on the top. But then farther down the hill, all the way down to 3,000 feet, we're going to see about 6 to 18 inches of snow along Highway 50. That would be maybe Camino will see some of that snow. Pollock Pines will see probably at least a foot of snow. And again, up on top, you'll see more than 3 feet. And the same will be true farther to the south. Places like Bear Valley will see that good amount of snow. Arnold will probably see maybe a foot of snow as well. So this is going to be a pretty good snow maker, probably one of the best snowmakers we have seen so far this season. All of it really starts late tomorrow in the Sierra, so getting away tomorrow into the Sierra during the day will be much better than what we'll see over the next few days. You can see that on the 7-day forecast. The snow develops late tomorrow, heavy snow on Wednesday and windy, and that snow will continue into Thursday, then finally clear out for the weekend with clear skies this weekend. It might be an amazing weekend to ski next weekend. In the foothills, dry during the day, increasing clouds, cool, highs only in the upper 40s to low 50s, rain developing by late tomorrow night. The rain may start a little bit earlier in Lake County, but still I think we'll get through much of the daylight hours here without any rain. The rain will be developing in the Central Valley late tomorrow night. Temperatures staying cool, only in the mid 50s and around the Sacramento area. We'll also get into the mid 50s, about 56 degrees. The wind will start to pick up out of the southwest at 10 to 20. The rain comes in late tomorrow night, and then Wednesday will be a windy, wet day, especially early in the morning. Keep that in mind for the morning commute Wednesday. Occasional showers on Thursday, and then once we head into Friday, we clear out, and then the weekend looks really nice. Back to you.
How about that? Nice timing there. Thanks, Mark. Just ahead, a fight between two young girls ends with one of them dead. What happened and what the child's family's asking tonight.
Also at 11, an extensive task, what it took to transport a 3,000-pound killer whale from Texas all the way to San Diego. New at 6, the LA County Coroner's Office ruled today that the death of a 10-year-old girl involved in a fight with an 11-year-old girl is a homicide. As Lolita Lopez reports for us tonight, the child's family says she died after surgery for a blood clot in her brain.
It was the dress Joanna Ramos wore for her sister's quinceañera in November. Today, Cecilia Villanueva prepares to bury her baby girl in the same white ball gown. The 10-year-old died from blunt force trauma following a fight, now being investigated as a homicide.
My mind is blind right now. And my heart is, you know, I don't know. I just feel so sad.
Joanna and another fifth grader took part in a pre-planned fight at a nearby alley just after school let out Friday. As seven other children looked on, it lasted less than a minute, according to police. There were no physical scars, but when Joanna began feeling sick at the after-school program she attended, the school called home.
I really did love her. I told her goodbye and then I'll see her later.
Joanna's sister describes her final farewell at the hospital. Joanna was taken there after throwing up and falling unconscious on the couch. She died 3 hours later. At Willard Elementary School in Long Beach, another sister places a note on a growing memorial, and parents read a letter from the school's principal.
We have support here for the students today, including counseling.
We are writing out, like, sorry for her daughter-in-law.
Her friends and classmates attempt to grieve through simple projects. Amalia Quintanar, whose son sat right behind Joanna in class, tells us of a gesture by the teacher, as told by her son.
One flower in the desk, in your desk.
Now, instead of planning her 11th birthday in March, Joanna's loved ones plan a funeral.
That was Lolita Lopez reporting. At Joanna's parents also questioning how a group of students were actually able to leave the school to watch that fight. Yeah. This is all part of the current investigation. We'll stay on top of that for you. In the meantime, GOP candidates gearing up for two big primaries tomorrow.
KCRA3's Edie Lambert joining us live right now with what we're working on for 6:30.
Galston and Kelly Commitment 2012 focus tonight, turning to Arizona and Michigan. The tight race between Rick Santorum and Mitt Romney in Michigan, with people starting to vote in just hours, and analysis from both sides of the aisle on what tomorrow's results could mean in the overall Republican race for the White House. Also, taking a twilight tour on Snowshoe, where you can experience the Sierra at night in a way you probably haven't experienced before.